Hello guys, in this video I'm going to be teaching you how to apply for the Erasmus Mundus scholarship. As you might have been a little bit familiar, first let me give you a bold claim that the information you are going to get in this video, you are highly likely not to get it from anywhere else. I have first-hand information about this scholarship, and I've actually interviewed a lot of awardees of this scholarship as well, and I currently speak with them to know, and even to some institutions as well that are actually behind the programs. I will advise you to stick to the end of this video, because I share some clues at the end of this video which can actually make you an outstanding candidate in your application process. And even, you know, the video might seem like a beginner to some people, but believe me, in between these videos there are a lot of in-depth information, very deep information that is necessary in your application. And also I share some very good tips at the end of the video, so kindly stick throughout the video to the end. So first, as we all know, the Erasmus scholarship is a scholarship sponsored by the European Union. It's a highly prestigious scholarship which gives you the opportunity to study in about 2 to 3 and sometimes even 4 universities across Europe. So, you know, what this means is that you can study in at least 2 universities in Europe. It might be more than 2, but at least 2 universities in Europe. Some actually go for 3 universities, some go to 4 universities, some go to 5, some go to 6, and sometimes under rare circumstances some even go to 7 or more than 7. But what determines this is not because you just want to be traveling. Your course will determine how much you are going to be traveling, but you can be sure that no matter which course you pick, you cannot do your course in a single location. It has to be in at least 2 locations. So this is the catalogue. And one thing that I also want to tell you about this scholarship is that, you know, beside studying 2 or 3 universities, you have the opportunity to get different degrees certificate. If you study in about maybe 3 or 2 universities, there is high tendency that you will get a certificate for all the universities that you attend in for the program. Or sometimes, in rare cases, there may be a single institution that will award the certificate on behalf of other institutions. But mostly, what people get is a joint certificate that you get a certificate from all the institutions that you attend. So it's a highly prestigious one. And also, there's traveling support. You know, whenever you are traveling from a country to your country, you get support for the travel. You know, some people even call the Erasmus scholars, you know, traveling scholars, because they travel a lot, and you know, because the travel is also funded. So that's what gives them the flexibility to always go on the journey that they want to go, from different institution to another institution to another institution, whichever way they want to go. So after the travel support that they give you, even when you are leaving your home country as well, if you are not situated in the EU, even if you are situated in an European country, they will still give you supplement for your travel. But if you are traveling outside of the EU, they will also give you they will cover your flight ticket as well. I think around, depending on how far, that's how they will measure how much they are going to give you. And even when you are after your program, they will also actually give you support for your flight, for your return ticket as well. So, and also one other thing is that they give you a monthly stipend as well, a monthly stipend of 1,000 euro every month, and sometimes 1,100 euro every month. And most of the programs are 2 years program, they are not 1 year, because, you know, the programs of this scholarship, they are actually, you know, they are objectively designed. They are not just designed. There's something that the European Union wants to actually there's an objective of the European Union, and then the European Union give out the opportunity for universities to come up with a program that supports their objective, and then this program was developed based on that objective, and then they come up with different programs. And then we have different programs. When we get to the catalog, we have about currently we have 135 programs there. So you can only choose from these 135 programs. You cannot choose beyond these programs. But of course, whatever course you study, you will still find something that is similar to whatever it is that you want to do in this catalog. For example, maybe you study law, there'll be something like that's related to law that you want to do, that you will see out of this 135. You might see something like maybe human rights. I think there's even something like economics law or something like that that is actually there. So you can still see a lot of things that still goes in line with what you want to do, and you will still be able to apply for it. So how do I get here? So you can just come to Google and then type catalogue, Erasmus catalogue, and then this is the first one about for you here, and then this is where you are going to apply for all the programs. So this is, you know, many people actually know about this scholarship, but not many people even know how to apply for it, because the interface of this seems hard to some people, but it's not actually hard. You just have to navigate through it, you know, the way it's supposed to be navigated. So it's not hard at all. So this is the catalog. This is the catalog that holds all the programs. You can apply for any program. So yeah, and sometimes too, you may even apply if you are not yet a graduate. Maybe you are in 300 level, and when the next program is going to start, maybe in September, then you may, if you know that you would have finished your degree, you may still apply if you have all the required documents, which is actually your transcript and, you know, other things, your references and other things that you may need. So we still get to the requirements very soon. So now this is the catalog. It holds 135 programs. So how do you search? First and foremost, what we want to do is to search for the programs that you want. So these are filters that you can apply. For example, maybe I study in the arts department, so field of study, I can just come here. Do I want to enter chemistry? Chemistry is not related to my heart. Economics, information and science may be related. So, and then social science and humanities. Yeah, humanities. So I've selected this. So let me collapse this and then search. So it's going to give me courses now that is narrowed to information science and humanities. So now I have just 89 courses that is available, that people that's available for people in the arts, in this field of study, social science and humanities, and information science and engineering. So we have this Erasmus Mundus joint master degree in economics of globalization and European integration program on the engineering of data intensive intelligent software systems, international master in dance knowledge, practice and heritage, master in clinical linguistics, master in embedded computer system, global development policy, international law of global security, peace and development, master in work, organizational and personal psychology. You know, these are just some programs here. So this is the first page. You can go to the second page. Maybe you didn't see the one you want, you can go there. And you know, one thing is that you may not really be able to see or determine the program that you want by just calling on them like this. You have to sometimes click the program and then see the summary. The summary is always here. For example, on this program here, history in public sphere, you can click on it here and then it's going to give you a summary of the program. It's going to give you a summary of the program. Yeah, this is a summary of the program. Summary: history in the public sphere is a 120 ECTS EMG MD program offered by the Department of History, Central European University. These are the program countries, four participating countries: Hungary, Italy, Portugal, and then Japan. So you can study in at least two of these universities, but what will determine where you will go is, you know, there are always most of these programs are tracks. Maybe you are, for example, you want to do communication, and then we have under the communication, there may be communication in politics, and then communication in economics, and then communication in entrepreneur. So most times, this country may be assigned for people that want to do communication in entrepreneur. This one, Portugal, may be assigned for people that want to do communication in politics, and this might be for people that want to do communication in the last one. And then when you want to write your project, you can even still go to any of these countries, in as much as maybe the data that you need to actually finish your project is actually in one of these countries, and then you can write the institution that you are, or that you wish to travel to this country, so that you can have the data that you need to do your project, and then they will reimburse you to go to that country to do whatever it is that you want to do, which is your project. So this is the summary of this program. So after reading the summary, if you are actually okay with it, or if you are not okay with it, you can go back and go for the one, go look for another one. Media arts culture, this is another one. Media arts culture, this is the participating countries: Austria, Denmark, Singapore, and Poland. So this is the summary of the program, you read it. If it's something that you want or you think you have the qualification, then if you want it, then you can now come here after reading the summary and click on this. This is the program website. So whenever you want to apply, because all the applications are actually done online. So if you want to apply for any of the program, so this is the program website. If you click on this program website now, it's going to take you to where you are going to apply, and it's going to hold all the informations that you need as well in terms of applying, for maybe the requirements and everything you need to submit. You want to, maybe you might want to contact them to ask for further information. The program website is your go-to for this type of information. This is the program website, so you can read more about the program. You can read anything you want to do. You can talk about the admission, application requirements, this application requirements, this funding your studies. Some of this program, the program website, they have other way for your study to be funded. Some of them have other ways, except for Erasmus, that funds the program. So it is external funding aside from the Erasmus Plus scholarship. So team and network research. So this is a program website, though all the program websites are not designed exactly like this. So there are different information on different program websites, but this is the program website for this. These are the information that are made available. So you can go to application requirements and check what is required of you. Applicant to the media aid program must complete a first university degree. You know, this show a strong motivation and interest, have sufficient knowledge of English for academic purpose. They accept TOEFL, Cambridge, IELTS. We don't accept from, you know, this kind of an English test certificate may have expired if it was issued more than 2 years previous. We kindly advise you to check on your certificate. Other acceptable ways of indicating learning provision are proof of a bachelor's degree or a master's degree delivered in English from a university in Australia, UK, Ireland, Norway, Sweden, you know, South Africa, Canada, excluding online degrees, with the application based in the respective country when studying for the program. You know, these are actually all these programs are actually delivered in the English language. So they always want to have admit students who have a sufficient knowledge of the English language for academic purposes. So these are the acceptable proofs that they accept for the English language. Then work experience. So you will see everything that you want, acceptance of your degree. You will see everything that you need here. And then what do you need to do? You know, next application period for 2022 intake, this one is here. Let's see what we have here. This is the application deadline includes participant with Erasmus Plus scholarship. So early acceptance of application for external and internal scholarship, January 9, 2022, regular acceptance available. So let's see if this is open. Create an account in the online application system. So how do you create apply for this? These are the application documents that will be required from you. These are the application documents, application form, copy of your passport, curriculum vitae, which is a CV. And then, you know, most of the programs here, they accept only an Europass CV. Europass CV. What is an Europass CV? It's just an Europe based online platform where you can create your CV. So you can go there from here. Europass. So I think this is my home portfolio. So you can go there and then, you know, you can go there and then you'll be able to create your CV. So, but you have to log in first and you have to register first. So when you register, then you can actually create a new CV. You can create profile and then create CV from your profile and do everything that you want to do. It's self-directory. I wouldn't cover this in this lecture, but this is the website to create your CV. So going back there, let me cancel this. So going back there, you need your CV, letter of motivation that express interest in studying media arts culture, maximum of 1 page, final university degree, diploma from previous degree, transcripts of record, recent photograph, proof of proficiency in the English language, essay on state of the art of future in media arts culture, maximum of 2 pages, example of relevant work. So you have to check all this to make sure you have this to stand as a competitive card, to stand as a competing candidate. Because if you don't have this, if all these requirements, if you don't have it and you apply, you know, you may waste your application because you cannot apply for more than 3 programs. You have to apply for just 3 programs out of all the programs. You can't apply for all the programs and be trying your luck. If you apply for more than 3 programs, you may likely be penalized, and even if you get an application, an admission, it may be withdrawn. So they still owe the right to withdraw any application if they see that you flouted any of their regulations. So you only have the opportunity to apply for 3. So these are all the required documents that are required from you. So when you have all the documents, then you just come to the online application system, and then you'll be able to upload all the documents as it is required from you. So the space is used by enrolled students media. Let's see. So create a new account. You have to create a new account because we are new, so we have to create a new account. And then after creating the account, then you create your new account. Okay, I don't want to use a one that I have to create an account. It might take my time, but let me use one that I don't have to create an account. So this is it for media art culture. There are some that you apply for that wouldn't require you to create an account, and there are some that you require for that you apply for that will require you to create an account. So let me cancel this. So that is what you need. When you come to the program website, you'll be able to see all the information that you need, and then you can even go to frequently asked questions. Almost all of them are frequently asked questions. I think it's very important for you to check the frequently asked questions here. So you may be able to see how the application go. How, for example, I come from another feed, not from media art, media cultures or art culture. Can I see apply? And then you see your answer there. Yes, since media art culture is an emerging field, there will actually be few applicants who have directly studied it. We are looking for people who are interested in media arts and want to be a part of the future development of this field. Isn't it all just art? Why media art? So media art can be considered the heart of. So there are a lot of, is there an age, education, or any limit to who may apply? English was the language of instruction during my secondary education and during my university studies, or I come from a country in which English is the official language, or I am a teacher of English language. Can I be exempted from providing a test of proficiency in English from TOEFL, IELTS, or Cambridge CEC? So let's see. Applicants who have obtained a significant portion of their secondary education or their bachelor's degree or master's degree with English as a language of instruction in one of the following countries can be exempted from providing an English language test certificate. So these are the countries. Find out more in the section admission requirements. If you have any questions whether you might be exempt, please contact us. So one thing that I used to do, that I also advise people that follow me to do, is that, you know, some of these programs, maybe you come from a country like some African countries, you know, the only African country here is South Africa. So maybe you come from a country like Nigeria. So maybe you come from a country like Nigeria, and then, you know, Nigeria is not listed here. What you just have to do is to write them that, okay, this is your story, this is how you achieve your education, and you would really want to be exempted from writing this professional exam, because the exams sometimes are expensive and you may not want to go to the ado of this program. And, you know, even if you write them and then you are not accepted, that makes it a loss on your side. So you may want to write them and ask for an exemption, even though you may not be listed there. So that's what some people do, and most times they accept, and some programs will not accept. They will still want you to write the exam. So always check the frequently asked question, and then there's always contact. You can always contact them. There's always contact. You can always find how to contact them on their page. Let's go down. We'll see contact. Yes, we'll see contact. Meet other contact department. So you always find their Gmail. The information contact, yeah, this is the contact. So this is the Gmail. You can, whatever question you have, you can ask them. They are always ready to answer all your questions. So that is for this program. That is how the interface of this one looks. So let me go for another program. Let me look for another program that I can still apply for to show you that we have different ways of applying. We have different methods of applying. It's not just one, and the requirements are different sometimes, because in the requirement is program based. So you cannot say, okay, because this requirement is what a friend of mine actually used to gain his own admission, and then you think that's the requirement that will be needed from you to know. It might be different. The programs are different in scope and structure, and then the requirements are also different as well. So I'm looking for another familiar program that we can apply for, that we don't have to, you know, don't have to register on a portal. Yeah, so this is the program I'm looking for, in journalism. So I click it. So these are the program countries: Denmark, UK, Germany, Australia, US, South Africa, and the likes. So, you know, you won't have to go to all the countries, but you will go to a country that has to deal with the tracks that you are studying, because this is just Erasmus Mundus Master Journalism, Media and Globalization. So there are different tracks. If you come here, they have politics and communication. If you are doing politics and communication track under that title, under that program, you will go to University of Amsterdam, which is Netherlands. And then if you are doing business and innovation, you go to City University of London, which is UTSC, which is London. You will go to totalitarian and trans, if you are doing totalitarianism and transition, you go to Charles University, which has Prague. If you were doing cultures and context, you go to Ludwig Maximilian University, which has Munich. So that's just that. So that, just to explain that, you won't go to all the countries. So you can read up on the what this course is on, to the summary, what it's all about, and then when you come here to the program website, and then you will see how to apply and the requirements that are expected from you. So this admission requirement, this one has selection criteria. It gives you, okay, these are the criteria for selection, tuition and scholarship, the scholarship that are available, Erasmus scholarship, and even other scholarship that may be different from an Erasmus scholarship. So application process. So let's go first to the most important, which is admission requirements, to know if you are qualified for it or not. So a bachelor's degree within a relevant field. So this is it. When commencing the module, you just have to read up on this, and then documentation of your English skills if you are not a native English speaker. So these are what is expected. What English native speaker means that, okay, English is your mother tongue. It doesn't mean that you are always speaking English. You know, there are some people that have spoken English all their entire life in South Africa. They don't even understand another language, but because South Africa is not a native speaker of English language, they have their own different native language. So that is what it means. But if I a citizen of the US, you living in the US, so you can be considered, you are known as a native English speaker. So that is for native. So if you are not a native English speaker, you are expected to write IELTS, TOEFL, Cambridge, and then we consider applicants to be native English if they come from any of these countries, maybe Antigua and Barbuda, Australia, Bahamas, Barbados, Belize, Canada, you know, all these countries. And also, before taking the highest test, you must select Aarhus University as a receiver of your highest test results. So you have to be careful. You know, one thing about application for scholarship is having a ear to details and having attention to details. You know, a little bit of details can actually disqualify you, because scholarships are competitive, and you know, when there are equal candidates that may be picked, because sometimes there may be equal candidates, and when there are equal candidates, what will actually make you distinct is that you have attention, that you put your application is totally perfect. That's what, so you have to read all the details. So, and this one gives an opportunity for applying for a test exemption. So applying for a language test exemption, you have to write a letter. If you are not a national of any of the countries mentioned above, but you consider yourself a native speaker, you can apply for an exemption for the language test. However, please be aware that there's no guarantee that an exemption will be granted. So this is for this one. You can apply, but you have to please know that applicants who have a bachelor's degree in English language and or English literature from a non-English speaking country are not exempt from submitting an English language test. So this is just another one. So what this one is just saying is that, okay, you can apply for a language test exemption like IELTS and TOEFL, but you will have to write a letter for you to be exempted. And you know, your writing the letter will now be a basis to test your skill in the English language. And then aside from that, you have to document your native, you have to give a document, a formal statement, if you have studied in an English taught BA, that if your previous study, your degree was actually, the language of instruction was English language and the language of assessment was English language as well, then you may qualify for an English test waiver. But you have to do two things. You have to write a letter, and after the letter, you have to give a letter of English proficiency. And then another one is at least 3 months of journalistic experience. So because this one is journalist, you have to give at least 3 months of journalistic experience. So that is the requirement. And then let's now look further to a lot of other things that may be required. Let's go selection. You just have to browse application process. Let's go to application process. So we see a lot of things to. Yes, these are the things that will be required from you. Application form. This is the application form. You have to download the application form. And this is the application form. You fill it. you do a lot of, you answer all the questions there. This one actually doesn't, you know, your experience, journalistic experience, this one, you know, your statement of purpose, you won't just write it. This one, that's why I say you have just have to browse the information. This one has a different mode of writing your statement of purpose. It's actually giving you something to write about in itself. You don't just write, okay, this is how, you don't try to think, okay, what should you write? It's already asking you a question. What do you hope to do in your future career, and how concretely do you think the program as a whole, both year one and two, will help you achieve that goal? Character limit 1250, including spaces. So this one already give you a test to actually determine if your motivation for the program. So after filling the form, so you come back after filling the form. Okay, I didn't download it because I didn't need it, so let me back. So academic documents, let's check what is academic document, official graduation certificate and transcripts of records. So journalistic documents, proof of experience, your work sample with your journalistic document, language document, which is maybe you are writing for applying for an exemption, you write a letter, and then your English proficiency issued by your degree awarding institution if you studied in English, CV, you know, this one too, CV, Europass. This one even give you a link to the Europass, unlike the other one which doesn't give you a link. So if you click you follow this link, it's going to take you to the Europass website. You see this Europass website, and then you can register and then create your CV. So you can register, click log in to Europass. When you log in, then you'll be able to see register, and then you register. So let's go back. So this CV is academic and journalistic reference letters. So this is giving you information to share with your referee. You know, some this doesn't give. That's why I say all of these things are different. Their requirements are different, and the information that they also put out too are different, just depending on the people that are actually handling the program. So these are the information that this one are giving for your academic referees. That okay, this is your advice for academic referees. Advice for employers or referees from the professional field if you are referencing you. And the one good thing about this, sometimes just to browse all this, some of these programs is, for example, the knowledge you acquire for the requirement for referees here, the knowledge you acquire here, you can use it in another program, because you know it's an academic world. There may be different, there is still all sometimes similar. So the knowledge you gain here, you can use it to apply it to, for example, all the program will require you to submit a reference, and most of them doesn't give you the requirement for your reference, but this is actually giving you a requirement for your reference, and you can use the understanding you get from this to actually, you know, write your reference. To the understanding from this, you can send it to your referee to form a basis on how he or she is supposed to reference you, because you know they are much more organized and much more knowledgeable than you, because some people, maybe their first time of applying, and then the reference is also part of the thing that will be considered. So download the advice for referees as a PDF here. So when you download it, you can send it to your referees that okay, this is the advice, this is what you need to follow, and then documentation of nationality. Please include copies of your passport to prove your nationality. If you have double citizenship, please include documentation for both. And then special iconic needs. So when you get all these documents, when you get all of them, your application form that we just fill there over there, your proof of journalistic documents, when you get all of them, language documents, CV, academic and university reference letters, when you get all of them, documentation of national identity, special need, you may not need this one, then how do you submit it? You arrange your documents. When you have collected all the required documents, please arrange a single PDF file, including documents listed above, in the correct order. So when you get all of them, what they are telling you is that all these things, you have to arrange them in the way it is listed here. So some of these might be PDF, they might be Word, so you have to arrange all of them as a one PDF file, and then you have to name them as, or maybe the title of the PDF must be your full name, the first year specialization. So most of this program actually requires you to submit a single PDF for all the documents you are going to be submitting, and then there's a website you can get that you can actually combine and merge all your PDF. You can go to ilovepdf.com. So you come to ilovepdf. So this is merge PDF. So you select the PDF that you want to merge, all your documents that you want to merge. So you can just, you know, let me just pick this. Okay, this is a document, so I had more. or this is my personal own transcript. So this is my transcript. So maybe this is not the right arrangement. You can draw it to this place. So that's it. So you click on merge PDF. Yeah, now it's merging my PDF. Now it's finished merging. Now I can download it. Yeah, so it's downloading now. 8.7 MB. So this is it. So I can then open it. Yeah, so this is the first thing I put there, and then this is my transcript that I put there. So that is how to merge your file, and then they give you how to submit your document. So you just need to find the information that you need and how to go about it. It's always there, always there. So go to online registration, and then give your name, everything about you. Put yes where you're supposed to pick yes, and put no where you're supposed to put no. Make sure they don't make a mistake. Maybe I want to go for totalitarianism and transition, so which is a break, search republic, or business and innovation. So whenever you read the summary, you would have know what you are qualified for out of the tracks and what you are not qualified for. So you pick it, and then make sure you put yes or no. And do you apply for an Erasmus Mundus scholarship? Yes, because you know this scholarship doesn't actually require a different application for the program, another application for the scholarship. It's a single application, and as single sometimes as picking yes or no from a program. So this is how to apply. So maybe you want to do self-funding, you can click no, and that will increase your chance of being selected, very good chance. And then but you want to apply for the Erasmus scholarship, you click yes. You click yes. So I did not apply for a scholarship. I did not apply for an Erasmus Mundus scholarship. So if you apply for a scholarship, you have to choose which category you belong, category A or category B. Let me see, two different categories of Erasmus. So you can browse it, which category. I don't want to choose that by chance. So this for category. Let's check for the category that we belong to. Category B on the application form, you can be considered for this type of class if you are a resident of any of the EU member states. Yeah, if you are a resident of EU in maybe these countries, Iceland, Norway, Liechtenstein, Turkey, Serbia, or you are not a resident of any of the EU member states, Iceland, all these countries, then you are category B. But if you are not from those countries, you are category A. Let's look for category A. Yeah, category A on the application form. This category A, you can be considered for this type of scholarship if you are not a resident of any of the EU member states, Iceland, Norway, Liechtenstein, Turkey, Serbia, or former Yugoslavia Republic of Macedonia. You must comply with the 12-month rule. That is, you cannot have carried out your main activities, studies, work private, visit tourism, etc., for more than a total of 12 months over the last 5 years in any of the EU member states, Iceland, Norway, EU member states. I think they have about 30 members, and then along those members with Iceland, Norway, Turkey, and these ones too. So if you are not part of this the EU member states and then these countries, then you are a category A. So let me just put category A because I'm not in the EU nor in any of those countries. And then, are you a national of one of the above English language proficiency record? So just pick whichever one is relevant to you. Maybe you are applying for an exemption. I'm applying for exemption. And then put whatever it is that you need, everything that's required for you. And then this is where you will actually upload your documents. So these all the files, the document is also give you. Please make sure that your PDF is one single file, including the following documents in this specific order: your application form, as you've done application academic documents, as you would have merged it in ilovepdf.com. So and then you choose the PDF, and then you choose it, and then you put it, and then you declare, you confirm, and then you proceed, and then your application will be submitted. I don't want to send the spam message, that's why I didn't proceed with this. So you know, it's giving me error that I did not fill out this feed. But if you've done that, then you'll be able to submit your application. So that is how for applying for the Erasmus scholarship. So there are different programs with different requirements, with different information that are provided. So you just have to unnecessarily look for the programs that you want through this catalog, and there are some the application window is always between September and January, and sometimes too in the space of window you will familiarize yourself with this catalog very well. There may be some programs that will come up, and then maybe the he just finance the program, and then they might even come up in February. So depending on, but those ones are under various circumstances. So you can keep browsing the website to know if it is updated and there are more programs which may be less competitive. And so one thing that you need to do, you need to know to be able to distinguish yourself and make yourself a distinct candidate is, you know, especially in the aspect of your qualification. Sometimes some of this program actually compensates experience for your class of degree. Maybe you have a lower GP, and then your experience is rich, you can use your experience to supplement for that. And the one thing you need to do as well is to make sure your motivation letter is very important. Make sure you have a good story. You have a good story that, okay, this is why I want to study this program, this is how it's going to help me. And let your story not be just about you, let's build about the community. As I've said earlier, these programs are all designed with an objective, and it is only when you actually also meet those objectives that you will be a distant candidate that can be selected. A lot of people are actually contesting for this scholarship, but you have to distance yourself by knowing what is really required of you, knowing how you can use your program to better the community, better the nation, and better the world. If you look at it very well, most of this program are development based: sustainable ship and shipping, sustainable master program in security and cloud computing, UN master in surface electroradiation and photochemistry. You should know that maybe, for example, in this type of course, what they want is that maybe sustainable shipping, then sustainable shipping cannot just be for you to actually develop a career for yourself. You must be able to look what you can contribute as a whole, if you have the understanding of this course, to the world entirely. So let your motivation letter not be about yourself. Motivation letter is a very important part of it, and then your reference letter, to make sure somebody who knows you very well is the one that is referencing you, not someone that will give you that will edit the reference that has been given to other candidates before. The person that is referencing you must be able to, you know, like, reference you based on the requirement of the courses that you're applying for, because this scholarship is a prestigious one, and it is worth it when you're actually giving all the works that is required for you to actually get the scholarship. So that is it for this video. So if you have any more questions, you can put it in the comment section and I will answer your question. So thank you. Kindly like, share, and subscribe. Thank you.